Person of all the different kinds of protests that went on last year, and again going on into this year. This is a presentation again that almost was writing itself over time. And it's the person that influenced world affairs the most. Now, Charlie did a great job in posting my presentation on the College of Complex's website, because there's a picture of the magazine cover was included in this. Now, any of you that came here this evening expecting a discourse on leftist protest philosophy will unfortunately have to go elsewhere. If you want to raise it in the question answer discussion session, the rebuttals, that's great, but I'm not going to be doing that. You can find those kind of presentations around, and perhaps somebody will come here in the future and do one. In a way, my presentation, again, almost wrote itself, as I said before. The issues which I was working on were connected directly and indirectly with all kinds of marches and demonstrations. And the timing of the year of the protester and other progressive thoughts could not have been better, and this is because of current events. And I just want to say that unfortunately, because of time constraints and because the immediate urgency of what I consider to be the NATO protest and the events surrounding that, there's going to be some of the topics that originally were given in the subheadings that we're going to cut, and maybe we can get back to those in the rebuttal session or whatever, such as how I commemorated the 10th anniversary of 9/11 as a progressive social activist. That was great when I thought of it at the time, but because of NATO, we're going to be setting that aside. But we are going to be touching briefly on the war in Afghanistan. Another is that most of the stuff on wildlife conservation is going to be cut. So I'm big on that. We can get back to that later. And some of the carbon side of carbon-free, nuclear-free is also going to be cut, because some of it is included with the NATO protest stuff. So we're not saying it's not important. I know it's on the... It was in the reader listed as all the subheadings as one giant topic. But the kicker, the hook, is the protest. My year as a protester, the year as a protester, that's the overall theme, that's the hook. And then everything else is directly or indirectly connected with it. So, now let's get started with the big one. Sunday, May 20th, Monday, May 21st, NATO had a summit here in Chicago, the Southern Building of McCormick Place. Those of you that don't know, NATO stands for North Atlantic Treaty Organization. The G8 summit with the G8 nations was moved to the more quiet and secluded Camp David in Maryland. And they decided to keep the NATO summit here. The protest ended a couple of miles away in the more rowdier streets of Chicago, where people are out getting crazy, getting nuts. And we can talk about that later on. And there were a whole series of fun activities here that week surrounding the NATO protest. Now, I was one of the organizers, and I was the media spokesperson for the Chicago NATO Environmental Justice Alliance. and we were the environmental contingent for the NATO protest. There were, the photo ops were great for all of us, both online and also like on YouTube. In fact, you know, this is a selfless self-promotion, not selfish self-promotion. There were two photo ops of me with my sign, Nuclear Free Equals Climate Justice. One online, the Chicago Tribune, the other online with Red Eye, which is the free daily that's put out by the Chicago Tribune. So Nuclear Free Equals Climate Justice. So first off, this was designed to be used as a workshop during that time. It can be used as a speaking gig anytime. In fact, nuclear power will not give us climate justice, but what can? My name is Dennis Nelson, and I reside in Chicago's Bridgeport neighborhood. Let's look at the phrase climate justice. Our planet's climate system is like an ornery beast that we keep hitting in the face, and the consequences of doing so are starting to be seen. The science of climate disruption is pretty well settled. Our activities are largely responsible for the global heating that has happened over the last 50 years or so. All solutions to our climate crisis must promote equity, fairness, openness, and honesty. Appropriate technology is obviously a part of the solution. However, climate justice is a matter of values, and I'll add good values, not junk values. I am the board president of the Nuclear Energy Information Service, NEIS, Illinois Nuclear Power Watchdog Group, located in Chicago's Logan Square neighborhood. We at NEIS celebrated our 30th anniversary last year. Going nuclear free as quickly as possible is the smart choice. All commercial nuclear programs should be abandoned and phased out as rapidly as possible. The nuclear power boondoggle is a failed technology with no net benefits. Nuclear power is a necessary, uneconomical, inherently unsafe and dirty, wasteful, and just plain unwise. Nuclear free is a positive, upbeat thing, just like smoke free is. I'm one of the original modern environmental No Nukes Safer Energy activists since around the first Earth Day, April 22nd, 1970, more than 42 years ago. Nuclear power didn't make any sense then, and everything since then has only reinforced my opposition to it. In the early 1970s, there were some well-intentioned but misguided environmentalists who supported nuclear power because of the air pollutants and strip mining from using coal. Now let's fast forward to the present. Now, in 2012, there are some well-intentioned but misguided environmentalists who support nuclear power because of human-induced climate disruption and mountaintop removal coal mining. The more things change, the more things stay the same. Of course, blasting off the top of mountains in the eastern Appalachians to get coal and then dumping the fill into streams should be immediately and totally banned. No more coal-fired power plants should be constructed. But there's no convincing technical analysis that any nuclear power is needed, either a massive nuclear expansion or even a so-called limited nuclear use. We want climate justice, but nuclear power will not help us get it. So many climate activists nowadays say, see human-caused global heating from a social eco-justice perspective. And we at NEIS wholeheartedly agree, no problem with that. However, nuclear power will not give us climate justice for these reasons. The lies and deception from the nuclear industrial complex, which I labeled pro-nuclear hanky-panky years ago. The establishment of a nuclear priesthood, a technical elite, to safeguard the longer-term radioactive waste of a full-blown nuclear electric economy. The surveillance of peaceful, environmental, nuclear-free activists by federal and state agencies, electric utilities, and private investigators. The harassment and intimidation of nuclear whistleblowers, employees within the nuclear industry and federal government who courageously come forward and go public about problems. Dirty uranium mining on Native American Navajo lands in the Southwest and the resulting water contamination and lung cancer deaths. This is not a thick list. You get the idea, you must be consistent. Your solution has to fit your goal. Those activists calling themselves environmentalists who support nuclear power in any way should examine their basic assumptions. No nuclear, no coal, no oil, no kidding. Let's go carbon-free, nuclear-free. the best technologically and economically feasible way for us to get off of all oil within 30 to 50 years without using nuclear and coal is called a carbon-free, nuclear-free energy pathway. This was researched by physicist and engineer Dr. Arjun Makhijani, president of the Institute for Energy Environmental Research. We can have a 100% renewable energy economy by 2040, 2050, and there are three primary components. First is greatly increased efficiency in using energy. Second is combined heat and power. Third, appropriate renewable energy technologies. One important policy recommendation is to immediately remove all of the wasteful, harmful subsidies going to nuclear power and fossil fuels. Studies released by the World Wildlife Fund and the UN Environmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC, show that our entire world could go 100% renewable by 2050. And here's a quote by Stanford University biologist Dr. Paul R. Ehrlich and Anne H. Ehrlich from their book, The Dominant Animal, Human Evolution and the Environment. It came out in October 2009. Quote, "The capitalism's biggest failure so far has been in not paying more than lip service to valuing environmental externalities, costs of production not captured in market prices, i.e. those external to the market. When you buy a gallon of gasoline, you contribute to the costs of climate change and lung disease generated by smog, not to mention the military costs of securing oil in unstable countries and guarding oil shipping routes. None of these factors is captured in the price at the pump. They are external to the market price. It has been said that socialism collapsed because it did not allow the market to tell economic truth, and that capitalism may collapse because it doesn't let the market tell ecological truth," unquote. Right. Voluntary solutions by the companies implementing greater true sustainability in their business practices are obviously not enough to solve our climate crisis by themselves, but they are still an important part of the overall solution besides providing a roadmap to an ecologically sound economy. Now we come to the book, Climate Capitalism, Capitalism in the Age of Climate Change. It came out April 2011 by L. Hunter Lovins and Boyd Cohen. Quote, "Seizing the smart energy opportunity. Investing in energy efficiency and renewable energy will generate jobs and help build strong companies, communities, and countries. There has never been a greater opportunity for entrepreneurs to combine the best energy efficiency technology with the wave of renewable technologies now sweeping the market. These companies will make a lot of money while helping communities enhance their energy security, improve quality of life, and enable all citizens to join the transition of a renewable energy future," unquote. And we're going to continue with a couple things that I prepared to be used in interviews, that sort of thing that I had with the media. One was about the event that took place Friday, May 18, 2012, crime-busting march against Chicago's climate crooks. And they were targeted in the downtown Loop area. I am Dennis Nelson. I am an organizer with the Chicago Naval Environmental Justice Alliance. This is the crime-busting march against Chicago's climate crooks. We are here today to call attention to four of the worst offenders that are guilty of deliberately contributing to our climate crisis. Our first climate crook is the Exelon Corporation, located in the Chase Building on South Dearborn, the country's largest nuclear utility. Even just over 1 year after the start of the Fukushima nuclear disaster, Exelon is guilty of the crime of pushing nuclear power as a so-called solution to climate disruption. Nuclear power is not clean, safe, economical, and green. In fact, nuclear will only make our climate crisis even worse. Nuclear foolishly wastes valuable resources that could instead be used to promote cleaner, safer, and cheaper energy choices, energy efficiency, cogeneration, and renewable sources, keeping more carbon emissions out of our atmosphere faster. Our second climate crook is BP. That was the BP bridge in Millennium Park. the letters B and P certainly do not stand for beyond pollution. It seems that most people have forgotten about the massive Gulf of Mexico oil spill over 2 years ago, America's most serious environmental disaster. The ecological and economic damages from this still continue. BP is guilty of the crime of still wanting to drill, baby, drill, keeping us addicted to dirty offshore oil. Our third climate crook is the Canadian consulate found on North Stetson. The Canadian government is guilty of the crime of destroying boreal forests in the province of Alberta to develop tar sand synthetic oil. These tar sand deposits contain twice the amount of carbon that has been emitted by global oil use in our entire history. The Canadian government is also guilty of promoting the dangerous and unnecessary Keystone XL pipeline, a 1,700-mile-long climate bomb fused to carry this dirty tar sand sin crew. Our fourth and final climate crook is the Illinois Department of Commerce and Economic Opportunity, located in the State of Illinois building. The Ivy CEO is guilty of the crime of promoting its one-sided and misleading coal curriculum. The state agency is using taxpayer dollars, our money, to put out from the coal mines to the power lines for elementary and high school students. This biased and deceptive curriculum was written on behalf of the coal industry to sell coal in the classroom as a clean fuel. There's no such thing as so-called clean coal. The Ivy CEO simply does not make the grade. To sum things up, Exelon, BP, Canada, and Ivy CEO are all guilty of being climate crooks by committing the crime of pushing inherently dirty, non-renewable energy sources, Mr. Nuke, offshore oil, tar sand sin crude, and King Coal, that will release more and more greenhouse gas pollution. We must get off of all nuclear, oil, and coal as soon as possible. We must switch to a carbon-free, nuclear-free energy pathway. Inherently cleaner efficiency, cogeneration, and renewables will help solve our climate crisis, will also enhance our security, result in healthier lifestyles, and create thousands of good-paying green-collar jobs. And there's one more thing. As an experienced wildlife observer and an avid hiker, I'd like to point out that today is Endangered Species Day. Climate disruption is already happening to some extent and is adversely affecting the Earth's natural environmental systems that are the hot spots for threatening endangered species. The koala bear in Australia is listed as a threatened species because of deforestation and climate disruption. A rapidly changing climate is also a factor in endangering the wolverine in Washington State and the pronghorn antelope and desert tortoise in our southwestern deserts. There is an immediate urgency in greatly reducing our carbon footprints and drastically cutting our greenhouse gas pollution. And next we have something that I prepared for Sunday, the 20th itself, which was the big NATO march and rally. I'm Dennis Nelson, organizer with the Chicago NATO Environmental Justice Alliance. We represent the ecological constituent in today's NATO protest, march, and rally. And let's break the vicious war climate disruption cycle now. About 97% of all climate scientists who publish in peer-reviewed scientific publications agree that our activities are responsible for most of the global heating which has happened over the past 50 years or so. We are calling upon NATO and the G8 nations to immediately break the vicious climate disruption war cycle. According to researchers at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln, our nation's military operations are protecting Mideast oil imports are generating larger amounts of disruptive climate change pollution than previously assumed. Protecting supertankers results in about 34.4 million metric tons of carbon dioxide equivalent each year. The annual cost of protecting maritime oil transportation routes is around $100 billion. Also, the Iraqi war has released another 43.3 million metric tons of carbon dioxide each year. The winner of Project Censored top 25 articles for 2009, 2010 news stories either deliberately ignored or downplayed was Pentagon's role in a global catastrophe. Indeed, the U.S. military is a major source of environmental pollution. In fact, all activities by our military, indeed, all of NATO's operations are completely exempted from any count of our country's total disruptive climate change pollution. This makes them completely exempt from all international climate agreements. This must be changed immediately. The international security implications of the situation are staggering. Let's consider the scenario where we finally go beyond the final point of no return and there's runaway, uncontrollable climate disruption. Severe droughts and heat waves will result in widespread freshwater shortages. Here in Illinois, we are in America's agricultural or breadbasket region, and our ability to produce food is bound to be drastically and negatively affected. Around the world, regional conflicts over increasingly scarce food resources and freshwater supplies escalate into global wars, possibly resulting in the use of nuclear weapons. I want to end on a positive note. With great challenges like these come great opportunities. What should we be doing? The Pentagon and NATO must be included in all international climate agreements, cut back on U.S. military foreign interventions, reduce the Pentagon's budget, use peaceful diplomatic means rather than war to resolve the situation with Iran over its nuclear program, end the war in Afghanistan as soon as possible. We should bring the war dollars home and spend them locally. We should redirect the defense spending on the Afghanistan and Iraqi wars to build real energy security in our communities, weatherizing and solarizing our residential and commercial buildings, constructing and installing wind turbines, making sustainable biodiesel and cellulosic ethanol, and so on. You could also call this noble effort, let's fight the energy war at home. That was done for the protests themselves. I use the computer of the Harold Washington Library Center. And on Monday, the 21st, of course, the day after the big protest, I went down there and found an action alert from the Nuclear Age Peace Foundation. Take action, get U.S. NATO nuclear weapons out of Europe. Well, how could I resist? Perfect timing. So, here we go. As an energy environmental researcher and a progressive social activist, I participated in the permitted and peaceful portion of the huge NATO protest march yesterday, Sunday, May 20th. This went out to President Obama and Dan Lipinski, my representative, and our two senators, Mark Kirk and Dick Durbin. Although the Cold War ended more than two decades ago, unfortunately, business as usual still continues with over 200 U.S. nuclear bombs in five European countries under a NATO nuclear sharing agreement. These B-61 gravity bombs have no conceivable use. They are provocative and unnecessary. The United States is planning to spend at least $6 billion on a life extension program for these B-61 gravity bombs. We are the only country with nuclear weapons deployed on another country's territory. All of Russia's tactical nuclear weapons are within its own borders. The B-61 gravity bombs would, under certain circumstances, be turned over to the host countries, Belgium, the Netherlands, Italy, Germany, and Turkey, and would be flown by the host nation's pilots to their targets. This clearly violates the spirit of the Non-Proliferation Treaty, which prohibits nuclear weapon sharing between countries. NATO nuclear sharing is a Cold War relic which has no place in the 21st century. I call upon you to act immediately to end all NATO nuclear sharing, repatriate the U.S. nuclear weapons in Europe for dismantlement, and negotiate with the Russians to eliminate all tactical nuclear weapons. And next we'll move on to carbon-free, nuclear-free, the carbon side of it, which means fossil fuel-free. And first up we have is that this is real progress. Let's move forward with the proposed US EPA carbon pollution standards for future power plants as quickly as possible. This was a testimony before a US EPA hearing that took place Tuesday, May 24th at the federal building in downtown. My name is Dennis Nelson, Dennis R. Nelson. I reside in Chicago's near South Side, Southwest Side, Bridgeport neighborhood. From my building, I can see Midwest Generation's older Fisk coal-fired generating station, one of the two biggest industrial sources of climate disruption pollution within the city's limits, which will be closed this September. I have a Bachelor of Science BS degree in Biology and Environmental Studies from Dana College, Blair, Nebraska. I am the president of Chicago-based Nuclear Energy Information Service, NEIS, Illinois Nuclear Power Watchdog Group, and our website is www.neis.org. Yes, I know that the US EPA's historic carbon pollution standard would establish the first ever national limits on climate disruption pollution from newer coal-fired power plants, with the N standing for nuclear in our name. I did not walk into the wrong hearing by mistake. NEIS supports this proposed carbon pollution standard as a key proponent of a carbon-free, nuclear-free energy pathway. The US EPA finally exercising its legal authority granted by the US Supreme Court to regulate carbon pollution will help us to make the smoother transition to inherently cleaner and safer energy choices. State-of-the-art energy efficiency improvements, combined heat and power, and well-designed, properly sited, appropriate renewable energy technologies. In return, we will enhance our security, promote healthier lifestyles, and create thousands of good-paying, green-collar jobs. This past Tuesday, May 22nd, I joined a student-organized protest of the Heartland Institute's 7th International Conference on Climate Change at the Hilton Chicago Hotel. We had better rename it the Heartland Institute's 7th International Conference on Climate Denial and Delay. With an office here in the Windy City, the Heartland Institute's nice, neutral-sounding name conceals its true mission as a climate denying and delaying front group think tank. We can no longer afford to deny the scientific consensus about human-induced climate disruption. About 97% of all climate scientists have published in peer-reviewed scientific publications except that our activities are responsible for most of the global heating that's happened over the past 50 years or so. We can no longer afford to delay taking the urgent actions of finalizing, adopting, and implementing the US EPA's historic carbon pollution standard for newer coal-fired power plants. Let's move forward to complete this process as soon as possible. This is real progress. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to testify. So that concludes my remarks. That's the testimony. No. That's not what it means. That's not what it means. I always do that to signify that I always say that when I testify because it signifies that it's the end. If there's any questions. Okay, now we already mentioned briefly the Fisk coal-fired power plant located in the Pilsen neighborhood on Chicago's near Southwest Side. Now I participated in the 350 International Day of Climate Action, which was Saturday, September 24th of last year, put on by 350.org, which is Bill McKibben's organization. If you don't know who he is, we can discuss that later on. Chicago had a Roll Beyond Coal, which was a huge bike ride from the Daly Plaza in Chicago's Loop to Dvorak Park in Pilsen. Now, the way I rolled down to Pilsen was using public transportation, but it all works just the same. And there was a big Roll Beyond Coal rally in March near Fisk. Now, of course, the mayor's office brokered an agreement with Midwest Generation, and both the Fisk power plant and also the Crawford power plant, that's the one in Little Village, are going to be closing this September. So it does work. Citizen action does work, getting out in the streets, as long as it's backed up with postcards, letters, emails, going to city council, that sort of thing. That's what the people like myself did. Next we come to No Nukes, the Smart Choice. That's my particular messaging. I made a makeshift cardboard sign and I held it at a protest sponsored by NEIS at the State of Illinois Building Plaza in Chicago's Loop. This was on Friday, September 30th of last year. This was a part of a National Nuclear Free Day of Action. This was in the aftermath of last year's Fukushima nuclear disaster in Japan. It started on March 11th of last year, and it is a disaster that is still in progress of happening. And we have a cesium red alert by Avast.org. And what's happening is, this is concerning the storage pool for depleted uranium fuel rods at Unit 4, the Fukushima Unit 4. Okay, a bit of background. These reactors are called light water reactors. They're fueled by uranium. Uranium pellets are put into fuel rods. The fuel rods make up the reactor core. That always has to be bathed in water, okay. When the reactor is refueled, about a third of the fuel rods come out. That's your high-level nuclear waste, and that's what is referred to as high-level radioactive waste. And they're put into, irradiated fuel pools. There are these glorified swimming pools, a type structure on site of the reactor. Now what's happening is that the storage pool at Unit 4, Fukushima, is a radioactive Tower of Pisa. It's tilting and it needs to be stabilized, and if something else happens, another earthquake or something, if the water is lost in the pool and the fuel rods catch fire, then we have a catastrophe which may dwarf what's already is happening. Now this is an online petition that goes to UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon. Now this says it's citizens of Japan, but it's everybody can sign it because we're doing this on behalf of the Japanese people. As citizens of Japan, we call on the UN to send an independent team of international experts to assess the safety of Fukushima reactor number 4. It's been a year since the nuclear disaster, yet a pool of dangerous radioactive cesium 10 times that of Chernobyl still lies exposed. This massive catastrophe in waiting requires immediate attention, but the Japanese government has failed to act. Only intervention by the international community can ensure the safety of the Japanese people. Now, as we have cesium-137 is really bad stuff here. And a little bit of information I looked up about that. It has a half-life of 30 years. It is a radionucleotide. It takes over 100 years to reduce cesium-137 to 1% of its formal level. It'd be an international problem if it's released. Now, if you take it internal, if you ingest it or inhale it, the cesium-137, this will allow this radioactive material to be distributed in the soft tissues, especially muscle tissue, exposing them to beta particles and gamma radiation and increasing cancer risk. External exposure to cesium-137 can cause burns, acute radiation sickness, and even death. And it's also an increase the risk of cancer because of exposure to high energy gamma radiation.
But it's delicious.
You'll put it on your cereal every morning. You'll go for it. And I just signed this online. This is a petition on behalf of the Japanese Nuclear Free Groups, sponsored by a group we work with in the Washington D.C. area called Beyond Nuclear. It's pretty pretty straightforward. It's an appeal for a nuclear moratorium in Japan and for the immediate removal of nuclear fuel from the Fukushima plant. And it's pretty straightforward.
Can you find that online?
Yeah,
we're pretty cool. Yes, you can. Just go online to Beyond Nuclear. Yeah. Now we come to fair trade, not free trade. I believe in fair trade. I do not believe in free trade. I'm not against trade agreements per se, but these trade deals must be fair and balanced. They have to protect our jobs, workers' health and safety, and environmental quality. And what's the best way for aggressive social activists like myself to celebrate Labor Day here in Chicago? And again, it was last year, and participate in the Labor Day Fair Trade Rally in March held. It was Monday, September 5th, again of last year, which was Labor Day. This rally focused on the negotiations for the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement at the Chicago Hilton, and I signed one of the 20,000 postcards that were delivered to U.S. Trade Representative Ron Kirk. And continuing on, this is an action alert from Green America. Really supportive of a fair trade. This is one of the groups that brings this Green Festival here in Chicago every year. And it's, I want Hershey to raise the bar and go fair trade. And this went out to high-level management at Hershey, the Vice President for Public Affairs, Corporate Social Responsibility, the Director, Vice President, Corporate Social Responsibility, and Responsible Sourcing Senior Manager was sent September 15th of last year.
We have a program on that.
As a conscientious consumer of chocolate, I have one very simple question for you. Where is the fair trade Hershey bar? When I go buy chocolate, I look for fair trade certified cocoa, because I know it was made without the worst forms of child labor, forced labor, or human trafficking. Fair trade also provides farmers with enough income to care for their families and send their children to school. I find it unbelievable that Hershey, a company founded on the principle of caring for underprivileged children in the United States, would be comfortable sourcing cocoa that has been produced with the worst forms of child labor. Shifting to third-party certification is entirely possible, as evidenced by other major chocolate companies, such as Cadbury and Nestle. Green and Black's and Ben and Jerry's have both recently committed to growing 100% fair trade. More and more consumers are seeking out responsible choices. The market is ready for a fair trade chocolate bar bearing the Hershey name. I ask that you meet the goals of the Raise the Bar Hershey campaign, which include an agreement to take immediate action to eliminate forced and child labor in your cocoa supply chain, a commitment to sourcing 100% fair trade certified cocoa beans by 2012, or at least one of your top five selling chocolate bars, which prominently displays the Hershey name, a commitment to making at least one additional top five selling bar 100% fair trade certified every 2 years thereafter, so that Hershey's top five selling cocoa bars will all be 100% fair trade certified within 10 years. I'm looking forward to the day when I can choose a fair trade Hershey product to satisfy my chocolate cravings. I want Hershey to raise the bar. Next, we have a letter that was based on information provided by the Center for Biological Diversity. This is please help reform trade practices that kill turtles. Propose native freshwater turtles for CITES Appendix 2, CITES. And this letter was sent, the same day as the Hershey bar thing. It was in a fair trade mode. So it was a Thursday, September 15th of last year. This was sent to the director of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service in Washington, D.C. On Monday, September 5th, 2011, Labor Day, I participated in a Chicago rally calling for fair trade pro-environmental provisions to be included in the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement. This is a list of turtles and tortoises which I have identified over the years during my many nature hikes and excursions. Illinois sightings, common snapping turtle at Lincoln Marsh Natural Area near Wheaton along the Illinois Prairie Path Elgin Branch. Western painted turtle at North Pond Natural Area in Lincoln Park on Chicago's north side. Eastern spiny soft shell along the Fox River and eastern box turtle along the Red Cedar hiking trail within Giant City State Park in South Illinois. Florida sightings, gopher tortoise at Oscar Scheer State Park, Florida soft shell turtle in Everglades National Park, Florida red-bellied turtle and peninsula cooter. Our nation is a key player in the international turtle trade, with exports reaching millions of live freshwater turtles every year. Most of these freshwater turtles being harvested in the United States are exported to supply food and medicinal markets in Southeast Asia. Over there, turtle consumption has soared. This unregulated international trade has contributed to the rapid depletion of America's wild freshwater turtle population. Wildlife biologists have warned us that our freshwater turtles cannot sustain any significant level of harvest from the wild without population crashes. Over-harvesting, i.e. large-scale collecting, is a primary threat to turtles and have caused population declines in nearly all of the turtle species that are currently extinct, currently endangered, or rare. Regulation under the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora, CITES, C-I-T-E-S, that's what it stands for, is necessary to make sure that international trade does not threaten the survival of our country's native freshwater turtle populations. Listed under CITES would remedy this situation by requiring adequate documentation and ensuring that trade is consistent with survival of the different turtle species. For this reason, I urge that the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service propose the following native freshwater turtles to be included in CITES Appendix 2. Alligator snapping turtle, map turtles, softshell turtles, spotted turtle, Blanding's turtle, and diamondback terrapin. Each of these species is subject to international trade for its meat or for the pet trade. Wild collection could hurt these species. Commercial collecting of wild freshwater turtles also intensifies the negative effects of water pollution, road mortality, incidental take by fishery devices, and natural habitat loss. All these factors are already contributing to declines of these turtles. In conclusion, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service must act immediately to stop the unsustainable international trade of these native freshwater turtle species. Thanks for your patience here, because I've got an outline for the presentation. I've got the individual things, so I'm like shuffling between two different decks of cards here that to shuffle accordingly. So thanks for your patience on this. Okay, and the last category I have is Occupy Wall Street. Occupy Chicago, financial reforms and economic equity. Now, right now, the Occupy movement is what I call the rock star protesting. What I mean by rock star is they're getting all the publicity, they're really getting the attention, they're out there doing things. There's some good stuff about them. There's some good stuff I like. There's some things that, we can get into that later. We get to the pros and cons of the Occupy movement. I just want to make sure I'm not a member of Occupy Chicago, and I'm not representing their views this evening. The Occupy movement was formed originally as a response to the financial meltdown on Wall Street. Therefore, I choose financial reforms and economic equity. The first is to stop Wall Street banks from gambling with our money, bring back Glass Steagall. And this is an action alert from Credo Action, which is put up working assets. It was sent May 21st of this year, and this is the simple click and sign the petition. It's pretty painless. It's time for Congress to put Wall Street reform back on the agenda. We support passing a new Glass-Steagall law to prevent too big to fail Wall Street banks from taking huge risks with people's life savings and then expecting taxpayer bailouts. And the next is from Democrats.com. They refer to themselves as the aggressive progressives, and I consider myself an aggressive progressive activist. And it's stop the super committee, super sellout. And this was sent on November 22nd of last year. Sent to my representative and our senators. This is a petition. I am outraged by the deficit cutting proposals under consideration by the super committee, which include deep cuts in Medicare, Medicaid, and Social Security while cutting taxes for the rich instead of raising them. Poll after poll shows Americans want the opposite, to protect essential social programs, raise taxes on the rich, and invest immediately in creating jobs. I have completely agreed with Senator Bernie Sanders, quote, the deficit was caused by two wars not paid for, huge tax breaks for the wealthiest people in this country, and a recession as a result of the greed, recklessness, and illegal behavior on Wall Street. And if those are the cause of the deficit and the national debt, I will be damned if we're going to balance the budget on the backs of the elderly, the sick, children, and the poor. That's wrong. As my representative, I urge you to stop the super committee, super sellout. Now, you can add your own comments, own personal message to Congress, and so this is what I added. Quote, every move that Republicans make, whether it's to cut consumer protections, roll back environmental regulations, subsidize giant agribusiness, abolish health care reform, or just drill baby drill, is consistent with a single overarching agenda to enrich the nation's wealthiest individuals and corporations, even if it requires borrowing from China, weakening national security, dismantling Medicare, and taxing the middle class, with the nation still marred in the worst financial crisis since the 1930s, Republicans have categorically rejected the one financial policy with a proven record of putting the country back on a more prosperous footing, unquote, raising taxes on the rich. As Congress looks for $1.5 trillion in budget cuts to complete the debt ceiling deal, the Republicans are insisting that none of these savings come from closing tax loopholes for the rich. Exempted from cuts are the Bush-Cheney tax cuts for the wealthiest 2%, $690 billion, itemized deductions for top bracket taxpayers, $321 billion, that's $321 billion, subsidies for foreign profits, $129 billion, subsidies for business inventories, $97.5 billion. Subsidies for oil and gas corporations, $44 billion. A carried interest loophole for hedge fund managers, $21.4 billion. And a tax break on loans for vacation homes and yachts, $10 billion. This comes from Tim Dickerson, the Party of the Rich, in Rolling Stone magazine, November 24th of last year, which has an excellent coverage about the financial crisis as well as the Occupy movement. Now next we come was a petition sent to Mayor Rahm Emanuel, stop the misuse of taxpayer money. And this is from Illinois PIRG, Illinois Public Interest Research Group, which is was started by Ralph Nader. And what happened is to see that it's about the Chicago Tax Increment Financing Program, or TIF. I see that you're having a program hear down the road about that. Should be very interesting. This program has overwhelmingly been used as a taxpayer-funded slush fund for well-connected developers and political supporters rather than a legitimate economic development tool that to really help the neighborhoods. Like in 2009, Chicago taxpayers unknowingly shelled out $31 million to United Airlines just to help it move its corporate headquarters to the Willis Tower. Now there's $500 million of taxpayer money at stake every year. Now basically just sign the petition to Mayor Emanuel and ask him to clean up this troubled program, vowing to reform Chicago's TIF process. Mayor Rahm Emanuel created a panel of experts to review the city's policies and historical use of this program. The panel has proposed meaningful reforms that would move the city in the right direction. It says here Mayor Emanuel is now considering what to do next. Now this was sent on January 25th of this year, but I think we still have a little bit of work that we need done if you've been reading the Chicago Reader recently. Now I'm not on the defensive about this stuff. This is something that it kind of is annoying to me. And this is, while everybody watches NATO, Rahm doles out TIF and charter money. This was in 5/24/12 a couple weeks ago. Summits come and go, but the mayor's handouts never end. No problems with everybody here is probably against the mayor handouts. But the point was, there was an article written by Ben Jarafsky in Politics. And it says a picture of the protesters goes, protesters at the NATO summit were clueless about the mayor's deal-making over the weekend. No, they aren't. This topic came up in the organizing meetings that we had. I mean, it was totally unrelated, but the people that I worked with knew about it. And he talked, why you were distracted by all the NATO nonsense that's been consuming our city over the past few weeks. Well, he's entitled to his opinion, and I have mine. The red zone and street closures, delays in traffic, all that stuff, put that aside. You heard a lot of the real reasons why we're out in the streets protesting. Let's make our military and NATO accountable for the global warming pollution. Let's remove U.S. nuclear weapons out of Europe. End the war in Afghanistan. Don't go to war with Iran. Let's don't see nuclear power as a so-called solution to our energy climate problems. It's not going to give us climate justice. This is not nonsense. This is why people like myself, we're really out there. And obviously we need to keep putting pressure on Mayor Emanuel's office. For what it's worth, I'm sure that you wouldn't have to twist the arm and leg of Occupy Chicago to get them out there in front of City Hall with a protest about this. And I'm not saying that they're going to do it, but I'm saying that I met the people and worked with them, and they're really out there, they're really go-getters, and they want to make things happen. So I'm just saying that if you wanted really to do it, I'm sure that Occupy Chicago would make it happen. I'm sure that there'd be those of us out there. That Frank and Margaret here participated in the March of the 20th. And one more thing for the economic stuff, and that is tell Representative Lipinski support President Obama by drawing a line in sand on the Bush tax cuts for the wealthy. I just sent that Tuesday of this week. It's by Credo Action, again, from Working Assets. Again, it's a click sign, automatically signed the petition. President Obama has long said the Bush tax cuts for people making more than $250,000 a year should expire. Support the president and draw a line in the sand by pledging to vote against any bill that extends the Bush tax cuts for people making over $250,000 a year. Well, that ends my formal presentation. Here at the college, always know it's fun surprises. So we have some other things that we can discuss. But at this point, I'll open up for the question and answer discussion session. And thanks for your attention.
Dave guess my question for you, Dennis, is this.
I'm listening.
You spoke earlier of the letter that you had written to Hershey. What about Mars? Where do they stand on all this? And are they being encouraged to market a Mars free trade bar too?
That's a good question. I really don't know. And there's still a lot of work that needs to be done on the Hershey campaign. There is a national alert from Green America about that. And I included this one. I already had a copy. I really don't know. That's a good question. That's something that I'll have to check on.
Dennis, you said you had this plan. You said that we could be 100% coal or nuclear or carbon free by something, I don't know, something in the near term.
2040, 2050.
What about the amount, the huge amount of installed diesel engines in the world, the diesel engines that power the transatlantic, you know, ocean liners that bring, you know, for freight and goods and oil and stuff, or whatever, you know, bananas, anything. All the farm equipment, you know, most tractors are diesel. Construction equipment is diesel. I mean, there's this. What about all that stuff?
Good question. He's talking about how we're going to replace diesel fuel, which, of course, which is based on oil. That's sustainable. Sustainable biodiesel. That's what it would be, not palm oil or anything
carbon,
like that. But
carbon in biodiesel.
Yeah, but it's less than if the process is efficient and such forth. It's less than what would be released by petroleum-based diesel.
How much less?
I'm not sure exactly, but I know it's less. That's a good question.
Bulger.
Tell us about your views of some of the newer reactors coming on, particularly the liquid fluoride thorium reactor and some of the propaganda coming out by the Thorium Alliance.
I had a feeling I was going to get that question. That's an upcoming issue here. We at NEIS, we oppose any kind of commercial nuclear fuel cycle. Thorium fuel cycle, uranium fuel cycle, plutonium fuel cycle. That's what you're talking about. It's not just because it's nuclear, it's bad. It's because it does have proliferation risks. Now, there's a claim that it will generate only 1% of the radioactive waste, which is questionable. But even so, do we want to produce any more high-level nuclear waste? We have no means, technical means of isolating, safeguarding high-level radioactive waste for the hundreds of thousands of years that are necessary. We don't need to produce any more. This is a proposed concept. Things like efficiency, cogeneration renewables for all intents and purposes are ready to go and are near commercialization. See, thorium is fertile, it's not fissionable. And has to be used with something that's fissionable. In other words, if you have a chain reaction like uranium or some other radionucleotide, thorium can be used around it, and then it's bombarded by neutrons. But it's not something that is in other words, it's not fissionable in itself. So it's still going to produce radioactive waste, and still is going to produce material that can be used to make nuclear weapons. So.
Okay.
We can get into more of that, of course, when the speaker comes from the pro-thorium group.
Okay. Walter.
Nice presentation, Dennis.
Thanks.
Until human beings perfect solar energy power nuclear generation, what's your take on a temporary use of coal gasification plants and the retention of emissions underground?
Okay. I'm going to raise an issue that was cut, and it concerns our friend Don here. It concerns a clean air rally that we both attended on the far southeast side of Chicago. It was Saturday, November 19th of last year at the Zone Youth and Community Center, sponsored by United Methodist Church. The point of all this is that one of the reasons was that there was a march past the site of the proposed Leucadia coal gasification plant, which is a big no-no. It will produce more greenhouse gases, is too costly, and really is not necessary. So that's the point that I was getting at. And fortunately, something like that was very, very good. And I was probably surprised to see Don there, as he was to see me. We both had gotten something from the Sierra Club about it. Now, I think you alluded to carbon capture and storage, and that's commercially improving technology. Again, I don't think that, again, no new coal-fired power plant should be built. The reason the coal industry is using it is just a justification to build more coal-fired power plants. Some people say that it should be used as a backup measure, and that's possible, but I don't see it as a panacea or a cure-all. In other words, well, we can keep burning fossil fuels inefficiently, and we can capture them and put them, you know, someplace like underground in a mine or someplace like that. It's still commercially improving technology.
Bruce Passoff?
Yeah, a natural gas versus diesel fuel. I was speaking to a BP engineer the other day, and he said that what they want, they have a goal where they want to get everything to be natural gas, the trucks on the road, the farm tractors, in 10 years. I mean, this is their own little private thing. But how does the natural gas go up against the diesel fuel as far as greenhouse emissions go?
Well, overall, natural gas is a burner, cleaner burning fuel. Unfortunately, we do have the problem with hydraulic fracturing or fracking, or, you know, not, this is a family restaurant, you know, effing fracking. And so that's the dark side now of natural gas, because up to this point, I think it was seen maybe at least as a transitional fuel. I support, that's one of the things that I couldn't get into, because I didn't want to, you know, be keep talking. I want to get to the discussion, and unless we want to be here into the wee hours of the morning, the fact that I support a moratorium on all fracking nationwide. Now, a bill to do that did not pass the Illinois General Assembly, and this summer session that I wrote a letter a week or so ago encouraging my state rep to support a bill that would have the strictest regulations possible. So I don't know if I answered your question, but it's something like, you know, yeah, let's use natural gas if we need it, but no effing fracking.
All right, Don, then Charles, then Sid.
Okay, Dennis, I wanted to ask what the current state is on the on international treaties on global warming. I mean, first of all, we had the Kyoto Treaty. One fool at a time, Charlie. All right, first of all, is Kyoto, all right, I mean, this is a complicated question, but first of all, is the Kyoto Treaty dead? Second, there was the Copenhagen conference, but what happened there? What was the outcome of that? And also, I want to know, does the United States government at this time have any plan to stop global warming at all? Okay, so that's my question.
That's three questions.
No, but that's
it's a three-part question.
Yeah, but it's
very good.
The question is, what is the state of international treaties on global warming right now?
Not very good right now. The Kyoto Protocol was ratified because the former Soviet Union went ahead and did it. We again did not ratify it. It was dead in the Senate. As far as international treaties, Copenhagen, nothing concrete happened there, unfortunately. But it did spur more grassroots local action. Like the city of Chicago has its own climate action plan to cut our greenhouse gases 80% by 2050. And the third is that currently any kind of climate treaty is then on arrival in Congress. Congress is not doing anything about it, and particularly doing an election year, Congress isn't doing anything about it. But there is a bright spot, and that is exactly what I mentioned. It was 2007, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled in a landmark decision that the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, U.S. EPA, could regulate carbon dioxide as a greenhouse gas, and that's what that testimony, the U.S. EPA testimony, was about, to support the rule. Now, I did other online written comments as well. because existing plants should be included as well. So we're not, I don't want the existing plants to get off the hook. I was just writing, I wrote that out like the night before the hearing, literally. And I did want to make it short to the point. Mentioned the protest outside the Heartland Institute's climate conference, because that tied directly in and people liked it. So the one ace in the hole, and I give, regardless of what you think about Obama, we can get into that. The administration is doing the right thing in an election year and going ahead and implementing to finalize this carbon rule. That's the ace in the hole, to use the U.S. Supreme Court decision to regulate carbon emissions from new coal-fired power plants and what have you, because that's really the only thing we have right now on the national level.
Charles?
You know, writing Congress is certainly commendable, it'll obviously. But in the environmental movement, we used to have a friend Butterfly Jones, and she lived up in a tree so they couldn't chop it down. And they had Environmental Liberation Front and stuff like that. Is that, you disavow this, and you seem to disavow Occupy?
I didn't disavow Occupy, I just think that there's mixed feelings about it. And first off, you didn't ask, but that has nothing to, what you're talking about has nothing to do with Occupy movement. The Occupy movement is like 8 months old, and what you're talking about happened, I remember when she went up and, you know, when she was protesting.
This is the year of the protest, they're not the year of writing a letter to Congressman.
Oh, no. See, I did. Oh, Charlie, I love it when you play devil's advocate with me. I really do. I really like, love it. And I came prepared for your question, too. In one way or another, I knew Charlie's going to play devil's advocate. So it's like, be ready, regardless. No, you need protesting, but you need things backed up. It's not protesting for its own sake. And that gets into the Occupy movement. I'll get to that in a minute. But is that you need to back up with other activities. I have nothing wrong with people out in the streets, but you need, just like in the case of closing Fisk and Crawford, need to attend the meetings at the city council. You need letters, emails, action alerts, postcards, whatever have you. The thing with the Occupy movement is that the issue with the Occupy, I support free speech, and I have something about giving the Occupy people the right of peaceful assembly in Chicago. In fact, that was a credo action alert that was sent to the mayor's office about that, and I've got it right here. The point with the Occupy movement is that the protest has become more and more their right to protest. And the movement needs to become more focused and direct. I've been involved around the first Earth Day, because the day before Earth Day, we had an Earth Day march from my high school in Council Bluffs, Iowa, Thomas Jefferson High School. We walked downtown to Bayless Park, music speakers, picked up trash along the way. It was a really neat day, because that same night I got my Eagle Scout Award. It was really great. The point is, I'm out there for a reason. I'm just not protesting the protest. One of the things I'd like to do, and I'm not seriously about this, but I can't get away with it here, would be to kind of have a tongue-in-cheek spoof of things like that. And that would be, if you remember the great Carnac, Johnny Carson's figure, go dressed, and I'm not going to do this, I would go dressed as some kind of a wizard or Kabbalah. Go to a demonstration and carry a sign, protest everything, protest anything, and just like prance around. But knowing me, I'd be, you know, on CNN, because that's the kind of stuff the media focuses upon. I wouldn't seriously do it, because I take myself seriously, but not too seriously. There's other issues I'd rather, of course, do. Plus, too many people know me, if not by name, but on site here in Chicago throughout the years, and they look, what, you know, Dennis is, you know, they're screw loose. They're wondering what I was going on. I'm just saying, I would kind of make fun of that kind of mentality, but I really seriously do it. You know, protesting is great, but you really need to back it up with other activities, and that's what the whole purpose of the presentation is.
But Dennis, where is your turban? All right.
questions.
Sure.
One, how many people showed up at the anti-NATO demonstration, and what kind of violence was there? I heard there was violence there. And you could talk about those two.
Oh, I don't know about that. Now, I'm going to say 15,000, 20,000, but I'm just guesstimating. I'm not even going by the unofficial news media. I'm just saying it was a lot of people. None of our people were involved with that. Frank and Margaret were there. They were, they got my attention and everything. But, we like to raise hell, but not that kind of hell. What happened was you had the Black Bloc protesters at the very end. And again, this is what I have a problem with, is these extreme, radical, militant tactics. And I think that the coverage in the Chicago Tribune was accurate, where Andy Thayer, who was here, talking about why we should oppose the NATO G8 summits. I think he could have done a better job. He got into more of his personal vendetta and his personal agenda and his personal politics more than the reasons why we really should protest NATO and G8. And again, Dave Kraft, NEI's president, myself in the rebuttal session, really got into more of what Andy should have talked about, but that's my own particular reason. He was imploring people to go west because we want to keep this peaceful. This was at the end where the rally was, and you had some 22-year-old, smart aleck that wanted to go east. I'm going to go and, visit, and he got clobbered by the cops and was treated by a street medic, great, and refused hospital attention. But that's what's going to happen. It's deliberately done for confrontation. Now that weekend, folk, rock singer, blues singer Bonnie Raitt performed at Chicago Theater, and we tabled both nights, NEIS. We were one of her causes. And I'm going to get to your answer your question. We there Saturday night. We had a benefit fundraiser that she did personally for our group. Got a chance to talk with her in person, meet her. Great. Sunday night was there. That was a really protest, rehydrate, and then be at Chicago Theater for tabling. When I came out, because everybody else left and packed up the NEIS stuff, I stayed outside on the folding chair and listened to the concert. I went in a little bit Saturday night. Sounded great. When I came out Sunday, there was a small group of Chicago police right in front of Chicago Theater and around. And of course, I was inside and I thought, uh-oh, something's going on. And then I found out that, again, it got really violent right at the very end, which, again, I don't support that kind of stuff. And none of the people that I am involved with had any part of it. Well, yeah, that's right.
All right, Jeff. Yes, Dennis, if I understood you a few minutes or so ago, you referred to emails, letters, etc.
Right.
Were you talking about Congress critters and similar types, or who were you talking to? And insofar as you were talking about Congress critters, etc., do you really believe that those things have jack of an effect? And on what basis do you, not 30 years ago, but now, what evidence is there that those things have any effect to speak of happening? Letters, emails to Congress critters. If I understood your
Well, I'm just talking about emails and things to all kinds of critters. You're talking about corporate critters, bureaucratic critters, Congress critters.
What evidence does he have that any of that has any effect at all? I'm just curious. Well, why do you think it has a means food of these people as opposed to campaign contributions?
That's a very, very, very good question, particularly with the U.S. Supreme Court decision that basically the sky's the limit. Down through the times, these things have had an impact. You said recently, but I have to have a historical perspective on this stuff. It's just like arbitrary. I've been doing this for over 42 years.
But doesn't the changing conditions matter, Dennis? In other words, yeah, sure, 40 years ago, maybe it mattered to those guys because the money wasn't flowing in like it's been really recently.
Well, again, I'm not speaking on behalf of, I mean, some people think there should be a constitutional amendment that necessarily support that at this point, that there may be something else that would be done. But
I'm talking about the ballgame as it exists now.
Just enclose a few pictures of George Washington and Hamilton, and it'll be no problem.
One more at a time, please.
I guess I'm an internal optimist, and we just have to keep pushing and pushing and pushing, and it did help, to get the agreement between the mayor and Midwest Generation on closing Fisk and Crawford. The Chicago Clean Power Alliance decided not to wait for the ordinance. It went ahead and supported this deal. Yes. Thank you. So whoever said tar sands is correct. Yeah. Letters and stuff to the White House were instrumental in the first decision by Obama not to approve the Keystone XL pipeline. Now, he has gone through in supporting the southern portion of the pipeline, supposedly to get around any kind of environmental. But that was a success story recently, and that would have come up. I have a bunch of stuff that I left out because I didn't think we had enough time. I did cover it briefly in the stuff about the NATO protests, about the climate groups, but definitely the outcry saying that the Keystone pipeline should be stopped was basically the only reason why the Obama decided to nix it, the whole thing. Now he's attempting to go ahead and do the southern portion, and again, pressure needs to be put on the White House and Congress saying that it shouldn't be approved in any form. But the Keystone Pipeline is a success story. If it had not been for the protests, if it had not been for the massive outcry, the letters and what have you, that it would have been approved by him to begin with.
Are you talking protests on the ground, or are you talking emails?
Talking about everything. I'm talking about circling the White House, protest that Bill McKibben, I've got the article here from Rolling Stone, he was arrested, I've got it right here, a copy of it. I'm talking about all the action alerts that I did from Credo, Sierra Club, National Wildlife Federation, Climate Reality Project, which is Al Gore's project, all these things that no to Keystone in any shape, matter, or form.
Right, Wesley?
Okay, I just wanted to comment on something that has to do with Occupy Chicago.
It's a with a question mark.
Yeah, that's the this is a question section here. A question. We have a rebuttal session, you'd be more than happy to get up and
In that case, Bill Wendt and then Walter.
Repeat the question, Bill.
Sounds kind of like, So how would in my carbon-free, nuclear-free energy pathway, how would I power the railroads and again, electrified rail? But if you have to clean up the power grid, have 100% renewable energy grid, along with a smart or smarter energy grid that more efficiently stores electricity, transmits it, whatever. Also, anything with diesel could be replaced by biodiesel. Or the use of hydrogen, which is still in the experimental stage, a hydrogen carrier. You can use renewable sources of energy to split water and then collect the hydrogen and use that as a fuel, but particularly, electrified railways.
In Los Angeles, all of the city buses there are operating on compressed natural gas, CNG. And the large majority of them in Boston and New York City are. Why is there no big push here in Chicago for such buses? You're one of the environmental movements. You hear anything?
No, I actually haven't. No. That's a good thing to look into. When I say that, I'm not putting people off, because after each presentation, regardless of whatever I do, if I ask one question, make one comment, or I'm a keynote speaker, I always go through an evaluation. Now, well, what could be said differently? What could be done, you know, if there's better? And the things that I say that should be looked into are things that that's exactly what I mean. These are things that I, you know, should check out.
Charles, did you have a question?
Oh, I thought you had.
All right. This is a little bit off subject, but you obviously have gone out to many different protests and various organizations and done a lot of keynotes. If somebody is wanting to do this for like a living or wants to be an effective protester like you, do you have like any tips or tidbits on like the development of their message or perhaps a little bit of tips for their message that they could use?
That's it. Yeah. That's about what if somebody's interested in becoming a protester, what tips would I have for them to
right, to be effective?
As far as
people
concerned. That's very good. That's one of the things that I really want to do within NEIS is what I call activist development. I think that a lot of activists are, I call the activist factoid approach. They get involved with throwing facts at people, this fact, that fact, and they don't really know how to message as much as what they really could. See, I have sales and fundraising experience. In fact, I should be starting a job this next week, selling for a green energy company over the phone, and that, you know, wanted to make your point that I've done largely done a lot of my activism has been on a volunteer basis. So again, if you want to get paid to do it, and I really should be paid to do this, but it's not. I'm just making an observation, not necessarily a complaint. You know, go for it and apply for the position. But in terms of messaging, again, as I said before, a lot of people think that it's anti-nuclear. I don't like anti-nuclear anymore because I think it's explicitly negative messaging. Nuclear-free as opposed to smoke-free. We're in a smoke-free restaurant right now. Now, I'm not saying you people shouldn't smoke. It's not the point. It's a marketing tool. For example, I was a traveling companion for my late mother after my father passed away in 90. We did a variety of trips, some of which I talked about very briefly. I mentioned like going to Florida, going to southern Illinois, the Shawnee National Forest area. The point is, smoke-free rooms is a marketing tool that my mother, who had asthma, looked for when she booked them, when she looked motels. If you're so adamant, I want to be anti-nuclear, at least say, well, I'm anti-nuclear, but if you're against something, you're for something else. And again, and then get into what you're doing. So that's the main thing right there. Might want to think about what I call 30 to 60 second encounter or elevator talk. You have a button on. Let's say I have the protest NATO, or I have stop nuclear power button, or something with solar or wind on it. You're in a conference, you're in an elevator with somebody, and somebody sees the button and goes, oh, says some kind of, are you an environmentalist or what is that about? And you're in an elevator, how would you make an impression upon that person? Not necessarily you can't do an education presentation, but how would you make a good impression in 30 to 60 seconds using buzz phrases? I used a lot of them in the presentation, and I'm glad Tim asked, because like healthier lifestyles, people respond to vision, values, and emotion, not just straight facts. The facts are important, but it's how we convey and how we use them. Also, economy, health, security. Any kind of messaging must include one or more, and I talked about that. I said to make this more secure, healthier lifestyles, good paying green collar jobs. So you guys don't know, but you were messaged and you probably didn't know it. Maybe some were, maybe some didn't, but I use this stuff all the time. Like I said, like my sign, which was a hit, nuclear free equals climate justice. I had good reactions, even when I was, you know, like carrying the sign, like after the protest, even like down the street, you know, holding it, you know. So, you know, there's a lot of stuff, Tim, that that I could, you know, go into, because I want to do a whole workshop, a whole presentation for NEIS about this.
Doug Binkley, Ellen Monroe, and then Charles.
Yeah, Dennis, getting back to that Keystone Pipeline, not to disparage the success of the protests in preventing the entire pipeline from being immediately built, don't you think it will be built eventually, and or at least a pipeline going across the Pacific Ocean, if by some fluke the United States portion doesn't get built? So the tar sands will get developed at some point, and... do you subscribe to the idea that that might mean game over as far as the...
Well, that's James Hansen's remark. That's the top climate scientist from NASA. And again, the stuff about the 1,700-mile fuse to the climate bomb was, again, paraphrasing Bill McKibben's article in Rolling Stone magazine. That's what James Hansen, the top climate scientist from NASA, said. If Keystone gets built, it's game over for the... climate, because we're basically locking ourselves into using an energy source, non-renewable energy source, with too much greenhouse gas. The late, great David Brower had an expression, inevitable, not if we say no. See, that's my attitude. I mean, like Rocky Mountain Institute, again, Amory Lovins' Thinking Dew Tank, the Snowmass, Colorado, the best way to predict the future is to create it. And that's the kind of attitude that we need to go in. And again, we talk about motivation, and that's part of what, you know, is a part of what we're talking about being effective activists, but it's also to strategize to win.
Okay. I'm just wondering whether you mentioned, I believe it's the Tenaska proposed power plant, and how they're... the idea behind it is that they would tax $350 million a year would be subsidized by Illinois taxpayers,
yes,
primarily businesses, but including, I think, schools and places like that. And for the businesses, it would be passed down to us. So I just thought I'd mention that because, you know, that's $350 million subsidy for forever, maybe, you know. For a really long time.
Yeah, you ladies and gentlemen are great. Yeah, Leucadia was not mentioned because of time, again. And the other one, Tenaska, yes, is at Action Alerts and stuff saying that funding for that should be cut for exactly the reasons that you're saying. Again, you can't mention everything, and you're not, you know, you're not a mind reader. You don't know what I have done or haven't or have done until you ask. But oh yeah, that's
from the
Sierra Club.
And with the Tenaska plant, they've talked about this cleaner coal, but they haven't promised it, or you know, it's not written down or anything like that. That's just talk. There's no.
It's all just talk.
It's nothing that they really. There's nothing keeping them to that if they do that.
That's right.
Yeah. Okay.
That's right. We should go for inherently cleaner energy sources.
Yeah, in the War Resistance League, when we talk about protests, we talk about acts of nonviolent civil disobedience. In the unions, when we talk about protests, we talk about sabotage.
Good.
What do you talk about when you talk about protests?
So, Charlie, what do you? I mean, question with a question, because it's you. What do you consider to be protesting? You're citing all these different sources, thinking, "Oh, we're going to put Dennis on the spot here." I don't think so. Yeah, Charlie, what do you consider protesting?
Oh.
No, I don't approve of any kind of sabotage. I don't believe in destruction of equipment or property, anything like that. As far as nonviolent civil disobedience, peacefully done, that's part of what's done at in front of Fisk down in Pilsen, that there were nonviolent CDers that sat down in the entrance and were arrested. Again, we were seeing again, and I did a little presentation. It was a discussion for White Rose, which is a Catholic worker house on the northwest side. This was kind of a a precursor to the NATO protests, and they had a mass mobilization dissent evening where there was a nice organic dinner before, because they grow their own food and they raise chickens that are egg layers. They actually have chickens that I got a chance to see that they lay their own eggs. And afterwards, there was an hour and a half discussion about mass mobilization dissent. And one of the things I pointed out is that the nonviolent CD tactics used against the nuclear power plants in the 70s are now being used against the coal-fired power plants. So no destruction of property, nothing like that, but you know, everything else, you know, go for it. I will personally be arrested, and I have very good survival instincts when it comes to a protest. I know when it's time for me, I've accomplished what I want, and I know it's time for me to bamboose, as it was on the 20th after the big NATO protest. Plus, I had to get up and rehydrate and go to Chicago Theater that night for the Bonnie Raitt show to do tabling. But sure, nonviolent CD, go for it, and I'll support you.
Okay.
We are approaching our rebuttal period. And I've lined up some chairs here for those of you who are
looking. We already asked a question.
Yeah, we got a lot of questions, but let's get the rebuttals.
If you wish to give a rebuttal, please take one of those chairs and
Let Don have his question.
Jeff had his hand up first.
Jeff, I do want to pursue the pipeline issue that you brought up in my dialogue before. I'm wondering how you guys know how it worked as far as how much difference McKinnon being at the White House made, how much coverage did that get on wherever, versus how can you tell how much of an impact the emails or whatever made. When you have multiple folks participating in different ways, how do you know what made how much of a difference?
Good.
Well, I don't have a good particular, what was more important, the massive protests or the things that I did. I mean, the proof of the pudding is in the eating, the old expression goes. I mean, the pipeline was nixed in its entirety due to a combination of things. I don't know, I mean, to me, what I did, I consider what I did just as important as the people protesting. Of course, Bill McKibben talks about him being arrested and being taken, you know, and things like that, what happened at the police station. I mean, that's a lot of personal sacrifice, and I'm not belittling that, but I'm not belaying the question. I'm just saying I know it's difficult to quantify. I mean, down through history, you've had, against protesting against the war in Vietnam, you've had civil rights, women's rights. I mean, you have people out in the streets, and you have people organizing, doing other things. And to me, it's like six of one, half a dozen of the other. I don't really think on terms of, I'm thinking, well, maybe the protests are more important than what I'm doing, because obviously they're putting their bodies on the line. On the other hand, you literally had millions of people like myself. Of course, I did multiple things, because I get different action alerts from different groups. Multiple, you have millions of people contacting the White House and Congress. So, okay. I mean, it's difficult for me to quantify what really is more
important.
I mean, you've got the coverage, you've got the media coverage of the protests, but you've got the undercurrent, you've got beneath the radar, you've got all the other stuff that's, you know, pile driving. So, yeah.
All right. You, Dennis, you mentioned earlier something about the environmental threat to pronghorn. I wanted to ask you, is the pronghorn currently listed as an endangered species? I think it has been. I mean,
yes, it is.
It is. Okay.
That was the point. Yeah, that's the point. Okay. Yeah, you know, today was an endangered species day. Friday, the day of, was the 18th.
Okay.
You know, because the 20th was Sunday, the big one. The 18th was the Endangered Species Day, and I threw that in. And yeah, that's the whole point, that it's Endangered Species Day talks about threatened, endangered, and periled plants and animals, and you know, the pronghorn antelope is listed as a federally protected endangered species, and that's what, you know, the habitat would be threatened because of, you know,
let's go to rebuttals.
Can we sell these Asian carp to the Southeast Asians too? Nuts.
Oh, the Asian carp? Oh, I talked about that a couple years ago. Okay. That's not really any kind of a protest, but again, issues that need to be addressed. I think what's going to happen is, I think that I favor is what's called ecological separation, that you're going to have to, you know, physically separate, you know, so that the carp doesn't enter our water system and out-compete the other fish. For what it's worth, I understand that they're a little bony, but there's a look into using them as a food source. And so I think that I, you know, and answer your question the best way I can, if there's a market for Asian carp, and there are people that are willing to eat it, Asians or what have you, they should go for it. Then I answer your question, because that's not really, there's no real protest about that, pro and con, but it is an issue that I addressed a couple of years ago here.
Mr. Paydock, and then Mr. Matter.
Yeah, Dennis, a protest by me incorporates some disruptive aspect. Otherwise, you're just having a parade, right?
This is getting redundant.
Rebuttals.
This is getting redundant.
Rebuttals.
We're protesting.
Yeah, protest can be fun. You've got slogans. You've got signs. We had great media coverage. We had a chance. We had the coverage on YouTube with the big banner. Planet over profits, which is what the environmental contingent was. You know, they had the banner, and I'm standing right behind with the sign. No, I'm just saying, no, it doesn't, Charlie. The answer to the question is no. It depends upon what your definition of protest is. If you think that putting on some kind of black face covering and going out and confronting the cops or holding a sign that says, F the police, which I don't, you know, I mean, I know police officers personally. One of my mom's nephews is a patrolman in Kearney, Nebraska. He's a good guy. But there are some police that are better than others. And again, I'm not basing my philosophy upon rock stars, but I saw Roger Waters last night at Wrigley do the wall, and he's a human rights activist par excellence, supports it. Amnesty International was there at the table with Don, I mentioned. And he's saying that when the police get too far out of hand, you're not just anti-police, when the police get too far out of hand, you know, things have to be done. That was the basic message. You know, it depends upon what you mean. If you think that's your idea of a protest, you know, to me, I think it just detracts from what the message should be, because that's what the media focuses upon. See, most people aren't protesters. Most people don't demonstrate. People were out there. They're out there at the Ribfest having a good time. They're down at Blues Fest having a good time. If I weren't here, I probably would be down, I'm serious, would be down at Blues Fest. That happened to schedule this the same weekend. I'm glad I'm here. I'm glad everybody's here. But the point is, most people don't picket, they don't rally, they don't protest, and this goes back to messaging. How do you reach out to those people? It's called with them, and that's what's in it for me. That's another sales technique. How do people benefit from your protest? What I talked about is the real message or messages that should get out, instead of a bunch of people walking around with black covering on their face confronting the cops, because that's what the issue is to the media. That's what the media focuses upon, and that's not what I see as the message that, you know, oh, there are a bunch of people that are, they're violent. Oh, I'm glad, I'm scared. One of my bartenders where I hang out at a restaurant, she said she was scared because of the NATO protest, because of all this stuff that she hears about, what happened in Seattle. That's the problem with it, that you've got, you know, these, you know, say yahoos, but people that go out there and let's just be militant and let's be extreme and let's confront the cops. And that's what the media focuses upon, and that's the stereotypic image of what is presented, and that's what people think, rather than what the real message is. So again, it's not even that. It's what you're attempting to what you're attempting to convey, what you're attempting to accomplish.
Big rebuttals.
Charles, you had your questions.
Bob. Last question.
Dennis, now you said that turtles are being there's legal farm raised turtles, turtle meat you can buy.
I didn't say anything about that. I'm talking about the ones in the wild. But I mean,
are people poaching them, or what's
going on? Yeah, that's the problem. Yeah, that's part of the problem. See, it's the wild freshwater turtles that are being poached and then being sent overseas, like to Asia. Farm-raised turtles are not, I mean, you can get into the animal rights thing, pro and con, but this is specifically referring to, those freshwater turtles in the wild.
Okay. Rebuttals.
All right. Rebuttals.
Rebuttals. Rebuttals.
Everybody, we move to our rebuttal period. If you have your own issues, concerns that you wish to raise, this is the time to do it.
About 4 minutes.
Now, I want to know how many of you have something to impart to the rest of us. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
About 4 minutes.
20 minutes each.
Five. No. Six. The speakers.
Okay, since I have the first thing, this is a very, very trying times in human history. We have a lot of ups and downs in our civil behavior. We have killed each other in many ways. We have built beautiful libraries with thousands of books, and then we burn them. And it seems like in the United States, we are in the process of burning everything. We have people like Bob Mutter that thinks that fuck the sea, we don't care, just destroy everything because we have to make money first. And then we put genetically plastic shit in the sea to make fish that we can eat. The lack of sensitivity to the problem that we are confronted is humongous. The lack of knowledge of the physics of what produces the heat in the earth, of what is heating the earth, the speed at which the glaciers and the ice is melting in Antarctica and in the north side, in the North Pole, is amazing. If, as we know, the sea is rising, is measured by satellite and so on. It's not a question of if or when. It is. It has and is still rising. But as we start melting the big ice on Antarctica, the rise will be at least a few feet, if not a few meters. Now, when we talk about the ignorance of or the denial of our politicians and the inaction of the politicians to listen to these problems, we confront with the Navy and the Army, which they are preparing and reinforcing the facilities to prevent the sea from flooding the ports and so on. So we know, the Army knows, the Navy knows, the Air Force knows that they have to take in consideration these changes in the climate, but we are doing nothing. I don't have much hope that we will change this because we want to have the fuels that we've been accustomed to use, the way we use it. We are accustomed to air conditioning and driving cars, etc., etc., etc. The time to change this is too short. 20 years is too late to change this. And we are not going to change before the 20 years. the estimates are that by 2050, the sea will totally collapse as far as to being a source of food. The seas are providing the oxygen, renewing the oxygen that we lack into burning fuels, and it does that by the green algae and plankton and phytoplankton in the seas. And in the last 20 years, we have reduced the plankton in the South Seas by 40%. It is not a little change. This is a tremendous change. How long will it take for the proportion of oxygen in the atmosphere to change when we are doing this tremendous damage to the plants and the animals that they replenish the oxygen to the sea? Well, it will take a long time. But the process is going, and the process is accelerating, and we are refusing to wake up. We make jokes about, we take, pot shots at how do you deal with the thing, do you demonstrate or not demonstrate, do you mean anything? It seems like we are not doing enough. This is obvious that we are not doing enough to change the attitudes and the politics that are guiding this thing. This is not going to change from the bottom up. By us conserving it, that means nothing individually. This has to come from the top. The whole system has to demand that we reduce the consumption, that we use different ways of building the cities, the whole thing has to be taken different. And Dennis, like always, he presented a wonderful and very concise presentation of how we can do that. So that's all.
Give me a 1 minute when I'm nearly done here. I don't want to overstep my time here. It was interesting to hear Jeff and Dennis talk. I think that's kind of the essence of the problem. Is there any hope? People like Frank, and I'm not speaking for him, but Frank and Jeff and a guy named Morris Berman wrote Why America Failed. People like that are saying, basically, there's probably no hope. Morris Berman left the country. He said, I've had it. I'm getting out of here. So, and other people like maybe Dennis, maybe Andy Thayer, Van Jones, there's a guy named Van Jones, I heard him speak. They're saying, hey, there is some hope. So that's really the essence of it. One thing that wasn't mentioned here is, but is implied, everything that was said, or at least not everything, but a lot of the things that were said, is community organizing. If you know that concept, you can see that, hey, it's discipline, it's focus, it's training, the elevator speech, all this kind of stuff, street theater, but it's all planned ahead. All planned ahead. And it's all nonviolent. If you're interested in that, and if you're old, go to Jane Addams Senior Caucus and we'll work with you. I'm a leader, amateur, volunteer in Jane Addams Senior Caucus. So those are some of the things. I got 1 minute.
How old is the old?
Actually, we have no age limits, to be honest. I'm just saying, if you're 42, I don't think you want to go to Jane Addams Senior Caucus. Go to Lakeview Action Coalition. But I would say about 55, our younger seniors are 55. And our olders are 90, something like that, 95, something like that. So, there is training at IAF, Industrial Areas Foundation, and Midwest Academy, and on and on. I've said enough. If you're interested in community organizing, see me or see Brom and get into Jane Addams Senior Caucus. And Dennis, It was a magnificent presentation. Thank you.
All empires have to expand or die. Rome, England, Turkey, France, to some of the empires that failed. U.S. is the latest empire and is expanding into Libya, Syria, because there's oil in those countries. We call it humanitarian intervention. And U.S. is stationing troops in Australia, the Far East, Myanmar or Burma, and troops into Colombia, fascist state. U.S. is overextending itself and will fail like all empires. As far as demonstrations are concerned, there's different tactics, and you have to go by conditions, under which conditions there are in the situation. And sometimes you have to experiment. And you could use the demonstrations in Chicago, you could use those types of demonstrations. If it helps to actually get results. But sometimes you have to use tactics like Charlie was talking about, under different conditions. And you have to keep experimenting to see what brings success. Otherwise, you're going to fail. So situations have to be considered, and you have to take in the type of demonstration that succeeds.
My name is Tanya Branshaw. I'm from
Rhode Island. I'm a protester. I protested at Purdue University. I protested in my home. I protested at Occupy Chicago, Occupy Valparaiso, the NATO summit. In addition to protesting, I had to come up with real solutions on how to solve some big problems that were going on. And what I did was I came up with a plan to have basic human needs met on the internet with major producers to buy collectively as a group and get cheaper prices on goods. This would address the population problem. This would address the economy by saving people money and giving them more money to spend on other things. It's an environmental program with green warehouses and recyclable packaging. I found some interesting information about some companies that I don't want to run my business today while I was here. This is... Is my time up?
No.
This program would satisfy basic human needs and allow a person to self-actualize. And when you get a society of people self-actualizing, you can heighten their awareness on other factors around them, on things that are relevant and need our attention, like our fuel problem, like our nuclear warheads, like environmental issues. So that's what I do in addition to protesting. And if anybody wants to get in contact with me about this, feel free. I'll be sitting over here and I'll be here for the rest of the night. Sure. All right. It's a website, and it's broken down into classifications. You start out by country, province, state, city, or street, and intersection. And the classifications are food, housing, safety, recreation, medical, health and beauty, gas and energy, electronics, automobile, and education. And there will be products offered with open contracts to manufacturers for people to collectively purchase products together and get a cheaper price by bulk ordering. There will also be links to the service industry where they can offer discounts and vouchers for services. Like gas companies could give you the cheapest price and you would be able to service at that gas station for a cheaper price on fuel. There's also advertisements with links to what to buy with all your savings. And this would be done internationally, so depending on the area where you're at, you'll be able to find what's going on around in your area, the top selling trends. What else? There would be strategically placed warehouses in different areas. I'm looking on the southwest side right now. I'd like to do the inner city of Chicago, because that's where the low economic areas are, and they would benefit the greatest. What else? I think it would be good use to barter peace in the Middle East by benefiting the population of the people and creating a better environment for the population. Because if we're upholding the people and doing what's beneficial to society, it gives us a forum to negotiate peaceful nuclear arms disarmament. And the environmental aspects that we touched on tonight.
I too share our speaker's last options that she's outlined with market-based driven solutions and cooperative buying clubs and things along those lines myself. My contention is a lot of that is already being invented in a lot of ways, because I work for an internet company that sells stuff on eBay and Amazon. And I can tell you right now, when we have the power to acquire a whole bunch of product from a large manufacturer, put it out on the internet at a decent profit margin, we can offer the consumer a very good low price on a product or a service. Also, you might want to consider, too, that are you familiar with Groupon?
No.
Okay, because they're a company that basically gives local deals to local businesses out on the internet, and they have been one of the largest publicly traded companies in the last few years. It's Groupon.com, and they offer you a lot of different things. And in many of the trends of with business and micro-marketing and social media, what you have talked about is exactly what's going on in a lot of the marketplace around the world to bring the costs of things down. You probably heard about the laptop initiative for laptops under $100. Many of the other consumer electronics and things along these lines, food that's getting a little cheaper to go in through cooperative things. If you look at a site called TED.com, that's a good site that gives a lot of solutions-based talks about, and it's about the movers and shakers of the world, and they have a lot of talks archived as far back as 5 years that might do it, you know. And there is a lot of hope in the world. You know, I hear a lot of people week after week after week telling me, you know, there's no hope in the world. We got to transform mankind. We got to do many different things that need to change the world. But from what I've been seeing, if you look in the right places, there's a lot of hope coming, not just from the bottom up, but from the top down.
I don't know.
Now, I have recently myself gotten into a little bit about examining nuclear power. I share that as too. I'd much rather see the world nuclear free, because it is a lot easier to have blow in the wind and make power and you know, use solar panels to do things. But personally, I'm not convinced that the renewables are going to do the whole job. And personally, I think that if the more we can get our power sources concentrated with something, I'm not going to get into the whole aspects of it, but the difference between what I've been hearing about with the reactors of today and those that are coming online or proposed are quite a little bit different. Now, I'm a reluctant supporter because I don't like the pollution or the waste or a lot of the other products involved with it, but it does present a little bit of hope, at least for, you know, giving us high scale, high energy sources that it can be locally made. I will not say much more because, as I said, the Thorium Alliance is coming. But the issue I really want to address tonight is, where is all of our solutions? I think they're coming. I think they're bubbling over and in a lot of cases, fairly obvious. The best way we're going to get off oil is, you know, with this $4 a gallon gas that we've been having, and even $5 a gallon gas we've been having, because when a source of energy costs more, and your electric bill goes up, you start doing things like conserving your driving. You start doing things like buying economical cars. You start doing things like winterizing your home. You start doing things like finding alternative power sources, like putting up your own windmill or putting solar panels on your roof. And as the market forces come in, they tend to get a little cheaper. I'm not saying that the marketplace is the answer to everything, but in a lot of cases, the prices of supply and demand do work and work very well. I don't like fraud, and I think that's a lot of the cases where our financial crisis has been coming. It's not because of a good old marketplace problem, but fraud of writing down and giving people mortgages that they couldn't afford, knowing this, and then of course they're going to default, and of course they're going to have a credit crunch. Our banks, I don't like a lot of times the bailouts of the big banks, but on the other hand, if we had a complete and total collapse of our credit system, it would have too been devastating. You know, along with our automobile industry, you know, we did bail them out and give them a little bit, but I like to consider sometimes the government is venture capitalist of last resort. Believe me, when you really looked into those deals the Bush administration did with some of these bailout money, these companies did not profit as much as you'd like to think. As far as the world in general, no, I don't think our country is going down the tubes. As a matter of fact, I see us in the next 100 years really starting to mushroom and really starting to blossom because of the way we are. I will not sit here and say that mankind is doomed or gloomed, because every time in the past we've always managed to find some kind of solution to our problems, much like what England did when they were on wood and went to coal, and much like when they found oil instead of coal. You know, one of the things that you don't realize is that coal and that the oil that we're doing today and we claim is a dirty fuel is certainly a hell of a lot better than having a horse fodder in the streets and polluted air from, you know, a lot of the things. If you look at Chicago, even in the 1910s, it was a much dirtier city than it is today. Sure, we still have air pollution, but it is getting cleaned up. And yes, I do like the electric cars coming down the pipeline. I do like a lot of the alternative energy things that are coming down the pipeline. But if you can do a solution that people really want, and I think it's best done through an open and free market with free of fraud, I think we're going to be in a much better long run. I like to close with a quote that Vladimir Zaworkin, the inventor of the television set, brought up. Competition brings out the worst in people, but it brings out the best in products.
The Rock Brothers made sure that the competition was going to be stuffed. Last week I started reading the effects of sugar on the world population. I'm going to start over with this, and because of the shortage of time, I won't be here, and that I won't be here next Saturday because of the conference in Schaumburg. And then the following week, I'll be in North Carolina working with some patients down there. And the week after that, I'll probably be at my women's clinic in Wisconsin. So what I don't finish tonight, I will finish the next time I see you all. Now, in 1936, the government did a 10-year study on the effects of sugar on a human, on rats, but it does the same thing for humans too. They have a very similar calcium absorption. The results were diabolical. What happened was the rats became cannibals. Now, this incident in Florida recently where this guy chewed the homeless man's face off, and five or six other incidents right after that where a student ate his roommate's brains and his heart. These are all sugar poisonings. They've been farming these zombies since 1936. Now, it took until about 1926 when they started that study. If you go back to 1493, and now this is a chronological history of health. We'll start with 1493. Columbus transports sugarcane to the New World on the advice of Queen Isabella. 1500. Dutch establish a sugar refinery at Antwerp and ship sugar to Germany and England. 1509, first attempts to restrict the right to practice medicine to licensed doctors. 1515, Spanish monks offer loans in gold to anyone who would start a sugar mill. 1560, Charles V of Spain built vast palaces using taxes on sugar trade. Said 1573, first German sugarcane refinery at Augsburg. 1660, British find sugar pushing so profitable it becomes a matter of national security. British passed the Navigation Act of 1660 to prevent transport of sugar, tobacco, or any other product of the American colonies to any port outside England, Ireland, and the British possessions. 1662, Britain importing 16 million pounds of sugar per year. 1665, London swept by bubonic plague. It was noticed that people who lived without sugar escaped harm. Over 68,000 people died from sugar poisoning. 1674, first mention of diabetes mellitus, that's adult onset diabetes, in British pharmaceutical Rationalis was a magazine by Thomas Willis, member of the Royal College of Physicians. 1700, British Isles importing 20 million pounds of sugar per year. 1700, refined sugar is the most important export of France. 1792, anti-saccharide, that's anti-sugar society, forms in Europe to protest effect of sugar on people. It induces a British sugar boycott throughout Europe. 1800, British sugar consumption reaches 160 million pounds per year. And, 1812, that's 200 years ago. France has mass planting of sugar beets and 500 refineries open. Over 8 million pounds of sugar are produced in 1 year. 1816, Britain passes an act which outlawed brewers from possession of sugar or molasses, since brewers had been adulterating their product with sugar. These ones here, so there's some more sugar over here. Okay, 1880, Sweden consumption of refined sugar, 12 pounds per person annually. This will go up to 120 pounds per person annually in 1929. 1890, This is a little aside. Andrew Carnegie writes a series of 11 essays called The Gospel of Wealth, a treatise which essentially stated that free enterprise and capitalism no longer existed in the United States because he and Rockefeller owned everything, including the government, and that competition was impossible unless they allowed it, because they closed all the oil wells and things like that because they were in competition. We know how cutthroat these two clowns were. Last paragraph. Eventually, says Carnegie, the young children will become aware of this and form clandestine organizations to fight against it, the protesters. Okay? Carnegie proposes that men of wealth form a synthetic free enterprise system based on cradle-to-grave schooling. The people who advanced through schooling would be given licenses to lead profitable lives, i.e. doctors. All licenses are tied to forms of schooling. This way, the entire economy can be controlled and people have a motivation for them to learn what you want them to learn. It also places the minds of all children in the hands of a few social engineers. Ben, thanks very much for your speech, but I doubt you did an excellent job. I'll be back in a few weeks. Got a lot more.
Okay, well, I'm going to mainly resume, as it were, debate I had with Dennis here and address Gene's comment about it. And then I'll have a few things to say about new plants in Japan, and if time permits, I will attempt to rebut some of the things that Tim said. But with respect to Gene's understanding of my position that there is no hope, that is an exaggeration. What I'm trying to drive at here is that the folks who are going to try to turn this thing around are going to have to think much more carefully about their strategy and maybe tactics than they used to, because the ball game is changing decisively. Constitutional governance by the people, that's dying. It's over, it's all over with the shopping. All right? And if anything worthwhile is going to be salvaged, it seems to me, it's going to be by the kind of guys that Frank referred to when he talked about how there's guys in the Navy who are worried about the sea levels going up, and they're lobbying evidently successfully for money to build higher walls or something. Did I understand you right, Frank? Okay, those guys, the guys that can pull those kind of strings, those are the guys, whoever those guys are who can pull those kind of strings, those are the guys you want to reach. And it's just a question of how to do it. And for all we know, this year scientist, the global warming guy who said that if that pipeline gets built, it's game over, for all we know, what happened was that the guys that Frank's talking about in that office in the Pentagon called up the president and said, hey, Mr. Prez, this year top dog scientist is saying it's game over if that thing gets built. You have to block it. And maybe that one phone call did more to block that thing than all of the deeds of everybody else over the whole country. We'll never know because Obama ain't going to tell us what kind of calls he got. Now, this is not to say that mass protest might not do some good in certain kinds of contexts. For instance, Occupy Wall Street sort of ran up the flag and let those in the Pentagon and maybe other places, know, hey, that there is popular disgust with what's happening. And that may, we'll never know, but that may have given heart to certain folks. I'm trying to remember, wasn't there some guy named Smith a few months ago or so who squealed on stuff that went down in Goldman or one of those places? Okay. Stuff like that. Now, who knows, maybe this Smith guy would have published anyway, maybe not. What the name, this game is going to be decided by elites. The masses directly do not have the kind of influence that they've had historically in this country. What we've got to do is figure out how to get to the elites, and occasionally mass action could very well
put a dent in those folks and inspire them to deeds they might otherwise not take. So that's my take on this. It's you know, it's a different ball game. It's a worse ball game, but you got to, I suppose you got to try something. All right, but understand what you're going up against. Now, a couple comments on the nuke plants. I wonder if you guys have gotten around to checking Wikipedia, Japan history of tsunamis in Japan. Turns out in 1896, there was one that hit maybe 50 or so miles north of Fukushima. And the tsunami waves, instead of being the 10 meters that were enough to clock the crap out of Fukushima, one of the waves got up to 38 meters instead of 10 meters. And yet these pricks built nuke plants there, knowing, and this was what, Fukushima was commissioned in 71. So a mere 75 years before Fukushima got opened up, a 38 meter wave smoked the coast 50 or so miles to the north. And they built nuke plants there. Nuke plants that didn't even have walls tall enough for to block 10 meter waves. And they knew 75 years before there was going to be a 38 meter wave. There had been a 38 meter, and there for very good reason to believe, sometime within the next 70 years, give or take, there was going to be another 30 or 40 meter wave. And yet they still built the damn things there. And our government let them do it, and let GE go over there and design the thing. And then we're supposed to have any kind of confidence in these people running this country. All right, the other one is from what I read, and this may have been on the oral drum. It is charged that what they did over there within the year prior to the 10-meter tsunami showing up is that they had sort of a Yucca Mountain plan. They were going to stick all the rods someplace. But in the interim, so it is said, they stuck them all on the roofs in Fukushima. Now, I don't know, this is, you know, I don't know if you're familiar with that or not, but again, gee, you know, I mean, you guys couldn't find any other place in Japan was less vulnerable to, tsunamis, okay, you know, than that, to put all that stuff there? Well, all right. I guess as long as Tim's here, I'll just suggest that okay, my time's up, I guess. Okay. All right, this is a really good presentation by Dennis Nelson. He had a lot of good information here. You know, now I'm not talking about anybody specific here tonight, but you know, there's a lot of people who are pessimists who feel like, oh, we're done, we're doomed, we're licked. You know, there's no hope, there's nothing to be done. Again, I want to emphasize, I'm not talking about anyone specific, Jeff.
Yeah.
Okay?
Okay.
Oh.
All right.
Anyway, and I don't believe Jeff fits in that category after what I heard him just say. But there are people who feel that way, who feel like there's just no hope. And to those people, I would say there probably is not anything that anyone in this room can do that will cause the earth to turn into utopia, that will cause all problems to magically disappear and for the world to become perfect. I don't believe that is ever going to happen. So if that's what you mean, that we're not going to achieve utopia, then yes, I agree with you. However, can we make things a little bit better? That can be done, and has been done by many people. You know, Dennis brought up my involvement in the Sierra Club. Yes, I did go to the Leucadia protest down in Hegwisch or whatever the heck that neighborhood was way down there. And I was at the Roger Waters concert last night as commanding a table for Amnesty International. So I'm involved in both the environmental movement and the human rights movement. Now, both of these groups have a proven track record of actually bringing about change. I mean, Dennis already mentioned how the Sierra Club was able to get Mayor Emanuel, of all people, to agree to close down Fisk and Crawford. And right now, we're campaigning to not open Leucadia. Okay. So Amnesty has a proven track record of actually getting people who are in prison freed, including the Burmese activist Aung San Suu Kyi. So some of you may have heard of her. Now, so there is one way, and now to Jeff's point about how do you influence the elites, well, you know, the politicians are the people who make the laws in this country. You know, big businessmen, the you know, the rich guys, they know that, and so they lobby them and give them a lot of money. We can't match them in money, thanks to Citizens United, but there are other ways we can, I mean, influencing them with money is one way to do it. But another way, which has been done by, for example, the Tea Partiers, is an election threat. To say, do what we want, or we'll vote somebody else into office to replace you. And you get somebody, so you run people who agree with you on the issues for office if you there isn't somebody there. And now to Tim, now I just want to say, the one point where I disagree with you, Dennis, is about Occupy Wall Street. I think you're making an unfair generalization of them. I don't believe that I don't believe the occupiers are just protesting for the sake of protesting. I think the movement started originally as a protest against the domination of our country by Wall Street. That's hence its name. And this is and more generally for the domination of the country by the 1%, by the richest people. That hence all this talk about the 99% and the 1%. Now to Tim's point about nuclear power plants, you're talking about, you know, free enterprise and capitalism, which I have no beef with, unlike a lot of people here. However, I would just say that nuclear energy has to be, it's not a product of the free market. It has to be subsidized by the government. You know,
One reactors, yes.
Yeah, the simplest way, the simplest way to end nuclear energy is for the government to stop paying for it. Okay, and by the way, I would appreciate if everyone would honor the one pool at a time rule, even if I'm the person speaking. Now, the final point I'd like to make about about what Doc said. Oh, you're going to give a second rebuttal speech.
Yeah.
No, not until we got to say it.
Okay. All right. You were talking about the Gospel of Wealth by Andrew Carnegie. I read the Gospel of Wealth. It is. I certainly didn't get that out of it at all. What I read, it was an argument. It wasn't an argument for elitism so much as it was an argument for free enterprise. Yeah, very similar to Milton Friedman's book, Free to Choose.
Yes.
I mean, one might argue that will lead inevitably to some kind of rule by a capitalist elite. But I did not find that to be inherent in the argument itself. All right, that's all I have to say about that.
I've been known to criticize speeches as eclectic, as being disorganized. And I think if our speaker tonight hasn't accomplished anything else, I think he's shown that an eclectic speech can be very well organized. But there's a bunch of things that, you know, I'm afraid I might have to be a little eclectic myself. I hope I'm not going to be too disorganized. But that some of the book synopsis that you can find on the internet.
There we go.
It's about a 12-to-1 condensation of a book I wrote about 30-some years ago. And among other things, it gets into a lot of financial fundamentals. And I think you can just find an antidote on this, all this stimulus, spend ourselves rich kind of thinking that people, you know, some people just can't imagine if there's anything else, any other way of looking at things. You can also see whether use of resources is the use of resources is slowly subsidized, and not only where this plastic shit comes from, but I think a lot of this global warming controversy is kind of a proxy battle between those who think that we're using too much resources, and between those who think we're not using too much resources, too many resources. So, was thinking also, and I haven't mentioned this before, but if it comes to that, maybe we're going to have to boycott chocolate over these child labor issues and so on. I'm not the one, I'm not really too much of a one to organize a boycott myself. But for a while, I was just trying not to take anything, eat or drink anything chocolate, buy anything chocolate. Except, I was thinking about, I kind of changed my mind, is I was thinking about boycotting the college of complexes for a while, but that's another story.
Good.
That would be an improvement.
Well, I think what I would do is put a little picket line out front, and anybody who comes in here would be scabbing. So, all right. There's only so much I can do with a 5 minute rebuttal anyway. So that's why I want you to read this. Even a 1 hour speech. And I guess I've gotten about 5 speeches out of that book synopsis. But,
Okay, hi, my name is Ellen. I'm just going to make a few comments. First of all, I was reading, actually this was an AP story recently in the past couple of weeks, about how certain parts of the Arctic have reached 400 parts per million of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, and that it is predicted that, in a few years, it'll be all over 400 parts per million. And there's like a website, 350 parts per million. They used to think that was the upper limit of what it should be, to prevent, I suppose, runaway global warming. And I don't know if they're now staying 400 parts per million, but it is a grave concern. And I think they were talking about trying to limit the temperature increase to 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit, which seems like an awful lot. That's just huge. That they would even be, they don't even think they could limit it to less than that, and it would I'm guessing it's going to be more than that. One of my brother-in-laws, who is a physicist, and is a very conservative guy, he was talking about how global warming might cause so many changes in the oceans, with it may interrupt the deep currents of the ocean, and that could even cause an ice age. So, some people refer to this as climate disruption, I believe, instead of global warming, because I'm not sure we know exactly what's going to happen. I did want to mention that Dennis was talking about the EPA has proposed this rule to limit carbon dioxide emissions from newly proposed coal power plants. And I think there was a hearing for a little bit about that. There was a hearing in Chicago about that, and they said you have until the 25th of June to go to their website or write them to comment to the EPA in support of this rule. So you can still go ahead and do that. I was mentioning earlier that there's this proposed coal power plant in Tenaska that they're proposing that would be subsidized $350 million a year by Illinois taxpayers. That's a little problematic. And let's just see, anything else? I just want to mention this a little off topic, but they keep on talking about drones coming over the United States, and they were talking about that today on NPR, and basically spying on us, and I just think that's really scary, and we should do whatever we can to try to stop that. Or we already have a problem that in the city they're going to be putting up speed meters
that's
all over
good.
The place. And
you serviced air missiles.
You want speed
what?
You serviced air missiles on the drones.
Do you want
so anyway, there's going to be a lot more speeding tickets going on because of you know, but anytime in a lot of areas of Chicago, anytime that anybody goes 6 miles above the speed limit, they're automatically going to send them like a $50 ticket.
Good.
And then if they go 11 miles over the speed limit, they'll send them a $100 ticket.
Good.
So just be prepared that you're not going to be able to go over the speed limit at all. And I suppose that's about all I have to say. Thank you.
You ever get hit by a car?
No, I haven't.
You want to get hit by a car 40 miles per hour?
Okay, well, I'm an old regular here. Old and a regular. I guess I wanted to talk about global warming and that. I think people don't realize that this living world is a huge web. And just like if you have a huge net and you pull on one corner of it, you move every other part in it, one way or another. And we don't realize it. We think we can just change one thing and that'll make everything better, but it doesn't work like that. So that and things have unintended consequences and all those things. So it's really hard to work on solutions to problems that we've created. 95%, 97% of recognized climate scientists support the idea that there's actually global warming occurring and that humans are the cause of it. And that's 95% of recognized legitimate climate scientists. You have a bunch of off-the-wall other kinds of people who are computer experts or whatever who are on the other side. Many of them are heavily subsidized by the oil companies who are denying that climate warming is occurring. And it's, or climate change is occurring and that humans are the reason. And it's obvious that the oil companies have an ulterior agenda on that. The second thing is that what is happening now, Ellen was talking about the 400 parts per million. Actually, that's not the case. The 350 is the point at which we cannot reverse what's going on. And many people feel that we have indeed passed that point. So our goal now is not to reverse it because that's not going to be possible because of the kinds of things that we've set in motion. The goal is to, how are we going to adapt to what's going on and mitigate the changes? The other aspect of this is that the kinds of human behavior that have caused this are consumption, or is consumption. Consumption of goods, consumption of natural resources, and the thing that really kicked it in was consuming the fossil fuels. And it bothers me when people feel that there are solutions to problems by encouraging consumption. One of the difficulties with using resources is something that it's counterintuitive. You don't look at it and see it directly. And that is that if we make things cheaper and easier, what will happen is that we will increase the consumption. So there are some people who feel that if we have an inexpensive, safe form of energy, that what will happen is that we will use that energy to burn up all of the resources that we have in this world in 10 years, not in 50 years or 100 years. And so that if we see, you know, by encouraging, and our society is very consumerist oriented. I mean, I've seen signs around, and I'm sure you have too, that says, eat the world, and that's literally what we're doing. So, I think people need, in my opinion, people do whatever they want, and individuals aren't going to make much of a difference in how things turn out. But we really need to look at reducing consumption. We need to look at using less. We need to look at reusing and repurposing what we have. Things like even recycling has its environmental costs. And setting up the infrastructure that you need to set up to do recycling uses up energy. You use up energy to cart the stuff in trucks to the recycling centers or whatever it is that you do. So we need to reuse and repurpose, and we need to consume less. That's really the primary part of the pyramid that we need to look at in terms of how we deal with what's happening. So, God, I hope my time is right, because if it is, that's the 5 minutes for Dennis to talk. Unless somebody else wants to do. Darn. Oh, good. Somebody else is going to talk. Excellent. Okay, John.
All right. I don't have much sooner than to thank Dennis for his talk. You have authority, and authority people in positions of authority make decisions. You try to influence them in their decisions. You also try to bring about change. Okay. Now, how do you go about doing that? How do you persuade them? Now, sometimes, some people actually think that you can go see, if you have a problem at work or something and you want change, that you go see a first or second level supervisor, and it's immediately going to affect the change that you requested. Unfortunately, that doesn't happen. And very often you come away with no change whatsoever. Sometimes you come away with changes you don't want, such as called unemployment. The organized labor movement has been involved in change since it began. This kind of thing, whether or not we do it within the realm of authorized means, such as the grievance arbitration process, changing of labor laws, not very effective, and more assertive means, such as protest. That's what I mean. It can be very effective. The only reason the NATO was effective is because there was, in fact, a threat of violence and mayhem. Attended to it. Otherwise, I'm quite honestly, otherwise it was just kind of a pleasant day in the park, in which there were many. And I won't go any more on that. People want to change. They want to do something. That's one way of doing it. It certainly is an indication people want to change. You know, if anything, you can measure that by the size of the crowd, whether it's 10,000 or 100,000. The Occupy Wall Street seems to have been something in that there may have been only a small number of protesters, but actually everyone was encouraging with that. And that's why it really magnified and was a little unusual. But I've got to address the young lady there, that things people can get into vehicles that weigh thousands of pounds and drive them at reckless speeds. You know, I don't feel that. And you know what I would do with somebody who got in one of those and endangered my life? I would put them in prison for 10 years. How's that? And that's being gentle. If you get hit by a car at 40 miles per hour, you know what chance, Bob knows this, what chance do you have of surviving it? About 10, 15%.
Wow.
That's only at 40 miles per hour. Now you want to let some jerk off who gets in, presses the gas pedal, and endangers all of our lives, and think, oh, well, but we don't want to do anything because we might monitor, we might infringe on his freedom to endanger our lives. I'm sorry. Thank you very much, Sarah.
had this thing on Fukushima, some of my researchers have come up with a very simple way to reduce the exposure of radiation in your blood. And that's with the spice rosemary. If you make a tea out of rosemary, you can have a reduction in the exposure of radiation from this Japanese explosion. There are many ways to reduce radiation in your body, but this is one of the most inexpensive ways to do it.
Dennis, get up there.
Spice rosemary.
All right, Dennis. He's got a rebut. Last speaker gets the last rebut.
Okay, thanks everybody for your comments. I agree that we do have trying times, but again, we do have opportunities to meet our challenges. Again, Dr. John Holdren is a physicist and engineer. He's probably one of the smartest environmental scientists around. He's Obama's science advisor. He says we have three choices when it comes to climate disruption. We have mitigation, adaptation, and suffering. Well, let's put the emphasis upon mitigation first. We look at adaptation when necessary, because there are already effects of climate disruption already being seen. And let's keep suffering to a bare minimum. According to Dr. James Hansen, we have 5 to 10 years to stabilize our carbon emissions. We can't do everything in that time period. At least we can stabilize and then start decreasing. And we want to work to make sure that our marine system does not collapse. Why America fail? I think that there's always hope. Van Jones spoke at this year's Green Festival at Navy Pier. Green Festival is a very positive, upbeat outlook on solving our problems. That's why I like going there. Community organizing is great. I wasn't a community organizer per se, but I did work with community organizers when I lived in Council Bluffs, Iowa, worked both sides of the river, Omaha, Nebraska, the No Nukes people. On the other side were like Citizens for Community Improvement in Council Bluffs, and the Iowa Citizen Labor Energy Coalition out of Ames, Iowa, worked on solar conservation programs, legislation, had great times doing that. I agree that the U.S. has overextended itself militarily, attempting to protect Mideast oil supplies, and that needs to stop. Again, the greenhouse gases that are released by that, I talked about, and of course the economic cost. The type of demonstration, again, we didn't get into any particulars about what happened Friday. It was a non-permitted event, and there was no advance press release. And I'm not pointing fingers, but I'm kind of surprised that nobody asked me about what actually happened on Friday, because it was interesting things that did happen because of that. Entrepreneurs, go for it. Self-actualization, no problems with that. Cheaper products by bulk purchasing, what to buy with savings, the new innovative things are going on all the time, the more the better. Market-based solutions, we need to put a price on carbon. Mm-hmm. I talked, was last July 23rd last year, about Al Gore's book, Our Choice, and one of the points I made. There was a quote, climate disruption is the biggest market failure in history because we have not taken into account in internalizing the externalities of what Paul and Ann Ehrlich referred to in The Human Animal. I heard about Groupon because in my job searching with the inside phone sales and telemarketing and whatnot, I did give a resume to them. Market-based solutions are included in Rocky Mountain Institute, has been mentioned, a book you can look at online called Reinventing Fire. And they say that we can go 100% renewable in this country by 2050, which goes along with Arjun Makajani's carbon-free, nuclear-free energy pathway. Again, I mentioned Dr. John Holdren. He advocates research and development into Generation 4 reactor designs, the advanced reactor designs, if renewable sources don't meet their targets. I don't necessarily agree with that, but that is his position within the administration. And he has been one of the foremost critics of nuclear power in the past. I think that the point was made that we need to remove all federal subsidies from nuclear power. $4 or $5 gallon gasoline, that's kind of interesting. Secretary of Energy Stephen Chu talked about, well, higher gas prices would emphasize people, to maybe drive less, to conserve. But this is an election. This is the United States. This is an election year. He was asked that question. He goes, oh, well, I've changed my mind. I really don't support higher gasoline prices. I think they should be lower. The T word is not very popular in the United States, particularly during an election. There are higher gas prices in Europe because of gas taxes. So kind of interesting note that I agree with Stephen Chu's point, but like the United States, because of that, he backtracked because it is an election year. This was he was called on this by Republicans when he was called to testify before a House or Senate, some committee hearing. I don't mean to make light of this, but I haven't heard of any recent protests against the use of sugar. If there are, they can use these as theme songs. Things like No Sugar Tonight by the Guess Who, and Sugar Sugar by the Archies. I just thought I'd throw that out. But again, I've supported removing subsidies for the sugar industry in order to help save the Everglades. The Rojo Sugar family. Not educational movie, but if you're into pop culture, they're a fictional movie, which includes none of the plot, was the movie Striptease with Demi Moore and Burt Reynolds. It's very amusing. It's based on a novel a book that talks about the Rojo family. And concerning Jim Hansen's statement about Keystone XL, there was an interview, very good interview, in Rolling Stone magazine with Barack Obama, and he touched on it already. And he made the point that, James Hansen is one of the spokespeople that's out there advocating, trying to warn us about climate disruption, and more or less kind of tried to get around the fact that what he was talking about, Keystone Pipeline goes through Game Over. And he said, yeah, but James Hansen is out there, and he's one of the people that, I support what he's doing. But what Obama wants to do is he wants to use all kinds of energy. I don't buy that. We don't want to, or we don't have to use everything. I don't buy that. And I have checked Wikipedia about Fukushima. Now, the storage pools containing the irradiated rods on the roof is kind of misleading. That's a generic safety deficiency with the Mark I reactor designed by GE. The storage pools were like 15 feet high in the air. That's what one of the problems is. And there were four reactors here in Illinois that have the basic generic safety deficiency, Dresden 2 and 3, and Quad Cities 1 and 2 are the same basic Mark I design as the GE plants in the Fukushima. The Tea Party is progressive, not progressive, but they were in the protester issue by Time Magazine because it was a generic overall view. Obviously, I don't support the Tea Party, backed by big corporate money like the Koch brothers. Now, there has been some discussion, the Occupy movement gets labor money. I'm sure they have some, but a lot of it is, legitimate, the grassroots from what I've seen. Now, there was a great article in Rolling Stone magazine recently about the battle for the soul of Occupy, or what I would call battle for the heart and soul of Occupy. And I've independently concluded the same thing that the article did. See, there's a debate within the Occupy movement about its very purpose. You had a young woman anarchist on one hand, and then you had a former IT CEO on the other hand, saying what I independently concluded, that needs to become more focused and direct. So it's not just me talking, there's this big discussion within the movement itself about which direction it should go. Interesting, I'm going to have to check on that of 400 parts per million in the Arctic. I've seen figures 387 parts per million, what the atmospheric concentration of CO2 basically is. The 315 figure comes from, again, Dr. James Hansen. That's in order to keep the type of climate that the Earth had when life evolved. Now, concerning drones, I don't want to get into detail. I did a 10th anniversary of 9/11 to end the endless war, and it was legislation to repeal the authorization for the use of military force. And one of the things had to do with that the authorization for the use of military force has been used to wage wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, allow U.S.-sponsored torture, unmanned drone attacks. That's the point I was getting at. This was one of the things that, because of time, I thought maybe in the rebuttal session we could get, you know, at least mention it briefly. So that was one of the things to commemorate 9/11. Again, bought and paid for experts. That's what's funded by the polluting fossil fuel industry. But they know how to get out there. They don't write in peer-reviewed scientific publications. They do op-eds for newspapers, things like that. One of the most notorious ones is Dr. S. Fred Singer. He's also been paid by the tobacco industry to poo-poo the health effects of secondhand smoking. Again, the climate deniers using the same tactics as the tobacco industry in order to create doubt. And there is no basic doubt on the causes of climate disruption. The scientific consensus is clear. Among the things I supported that I didn't include, an action alert by Credo, for example, to support extending the unemployment benefits. And I did participate, and this is one of the things I didn't mention, but I do have the file somewhere here. There was a protest sponsored by labor and like environmental groups in the loop last year in response to the Wisconsin governor's opposition to collective bargaining. One of the speakers there was Jack Darren, who's the head of the Sierra Club here in Illinois. Unfortunately, you know about the recent recall election. It failed, and the governor stays in. And again, you can use potassium iodide pills as at least the temporary protection to protect the thyroid gland from radioactive iodine, iodine-131. Again, appreciate everybody's comments coming here, and see you next time. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Thank you, all right. All right. All right. All right. To all a good night.